In this video, we will be examining the Sturmey Archer 5-speed gear hub. The particular hub we'll be examining will be the older style with the ball lock mechanism. The 5-speed is designed around the same basic principles as a 3-speed hub. To gain a better understanding of how this hub works, click on the red button below to first view a video on how a 3-speed works. Welcome back. Now let's explore a 5-speed Sturmey Archer.
Looking at the hub from the inside out, the first thing we're going to look at and talk about is the ball lock mechanism. First, what it is, the purpose it serves, and how it works. The ball locking mechanism is the means by which the individual sun gears are coupled and decoupled to the axle to select between first and second and fourth and fifth gears. It consists of two rows of three holes around the axle. Each of these holes has a 5/32 bearing ball in it. And inside the axle, there is a pin with ramps and grooves. Now, as we move the shifter to different positions, the purpose of the ramps and grooves is to either allow the balls to be recessed into the axle and allow the corresponding sun gear to freely rotate, or to push it out into corresponding divots on the inner circumference of the sun gear and couple it to the axle. So in this particular instance, I have the shifter in the first gear position, and this bearing ball is in the smaller of the sun gears, and it is recessed in the axle. This bearing ball corresponds with the larger of the sun gears, and it is in the out position, so it is engaged, has the larger of the sun gears engaged to the axle, and therefore that sun gear is non-rotating. So I'll take this out of here. Now these bearing balls, like I said, they're a 5/32 ball bearing is what they are. So if you lose one, you can replace it. So when I move the shifter to the second gear position, this ball is going to pop out. I'm going to hold my thumb over it so it doesn't go flying. Okay, now that ball has been pushed out, and as have the other two. So the three balls will engage now the small sun gear to the axle. Take it out of there. All right, so I've put a white sheet of paper behind there so you can see the light through. Now with, we'll go back to first gear. Okay, so now in first gear, we can see the light shining through this row of holes. So what that means is that the small sun gear is free to rotate, free floating on the axle as the balls are recessed in the axle. The large sun gear is coupled to the axle because the ramps are pushing the balls out. We shift to the second gear position. All right. They change places. Now we can see the daylight through this one where the large sun gear rotates, and this one is closed off, so the small sun gear is coupled to the axle. When we go to third gear, okay, there's no change. Third gear, as we'll show later, which of the sun gears is coupled to the axle has no bearing on third gear as it's a direct drive. Fourth gear, okay, fourth gear, again, no change, because in fourth gear, we still have the smaller of the sun gears engaged to the axle, and the large one free rotating. Fifth gear, once again, they change places. The small sun gear is released to freely rotate, and the large sun gear is once again coupled to the axle. So that's how the ball lock technology works. Okay, now we'll be putting the sun gears and the planet carrier in place. And it's very important that you take note of which direction the sun gears face, and getting them on there without losing the three locking balls can be a little tricky, and there's a spring that goes between them, between the two sun gears. Very important that that spring go back in place. Also, another critical step here is the timing of the planetaries. Whenever you have stepped planetaries on multiple size sun gears, there will be timing marks on the planetary gears. In this case, it's on the inner side of the larger of the two. Each of the three will have a timing mark. Very important that that timing mark be aligned exactly outward on all three of them in order for the hub to work. Now, if you're not familiar with the concept of the timing of planetaries, I'll post a link right here to another video that explains this concept. And if you look at the upper side of your screen right now, you'll see a red button. If you click on that, it will take you to a video that will explain the concept. And at the end of that video, there will be another button that will say return to the 5-speed video. Just click on that and it will bring you back to this point of this video. So after you've got the planet cage in place, need to check to be sure, just rotate it until the timing marks are all facing directly outward from the center of the pinion shafts, and all three of them need to be aligned in that position. And if it's off by even one tooth, it's not going to work properly. So it's very critical that you get that step correct. Okay, so now we've got the sun and planet gears in place. I'll just run through what happens in each of the five gear positions as it relates to the sun and planetary gears. So now we're in first gear. The large sun gear is engaged to the axle. As the ring gear drives the planet carrier, we have the maximum differential between the ring gear and the planet carrier with the larger gear engaged, and we're driving the output at a ratio of 0.667 revolutions output to one revolution input, and that's our first gear. Okay, now we move the shift selector to second gear. Now we've freed the large sun gear from the axle and coupled the small one to the axle. So now the ring gear drives the planet carrier at a ratio with slightly less differential. We have one revolution input to 0.789 revolutions output, and that's our second gear. Moving the shifter to third gear, no change. The sun gears have no impact on third gear as it's a direct drive to the hub shell. Fourth gear, once again, no change. We still have the small sun gear coupled to the axle and the large one free rotating. Remember, we want now to have the lesser differential between them because the power flow is reversed. We're now driving the ring gear with the, yeah, there we go, the clutch settles on the planet pins. So the clutch is now driving the planet carrier. All right, so the input going from the driver to the planet carrier to the ring gear to the output at a ratio of 1 to 1.267, and that's our fourth gear. Fifth gear, once again, they trade places. We lock the large sun gear to the axle. The small sun gear is freed to freely rotate. We have the greater differential between the planet carrier and the ring gear, and that is our fifth gear, a ratio of 1 input to 1.5 output. Okay, so now we'll do a rundown on what happens in each of the five gears. So we now have first gear selected, and we see that the ball ring is not driven by the ring gear as the poles are retracted. And we also see that the planet carrier falls behind the ring gear as the ring gear drives the planet carrier at a ratio of 1 revolution input to 0.667 revolutions output. which basically is two-thirds. So the planet carrier will revolve two-thirds of a revolution for one revolution of the ring gear. In second gear, the ball ring is still not being driven by the ring gear. Okay, and now the planet carrier is being driven at a speed slightly greater than it was in first gear. It's now rotating at 0.789 revolutions for one revolution of input. Now we're in third gear. Now the ring gear pawls have been released and they are driving the ball ring, which is driving the hub. So while the planet carrier is still falling behind, the hub shell is being driven faster than the planet carrier, so it's simply outrunning that. These pawls are just being ratcheted over. So you'll see that the cog, the ring gear, and the ball ring are all rotating at the same speed. So one revolution of input, one revolution of output, one-to-one, third gear. Now we're in fourth gear. Now if you watch the ball ring, you'll see that it's actually rotating faster than the input. Okay, both the ring gear and the ball ring are rotating at an increased speed, and the driver and the planet carrier are rotating at the same speed because the input is going directly from the driver to the planet carrier and then driving the ring gear and the ball ring at a ratio of one revolution of input to 1.267 revolutions of output for fourth gear. Now we're in fifth gear. Once again, we'll see that the input and the planet carrier rotate at the same speed, and the ring gear and the ball ring rotate at a speed 1.5 times. All right, so one revolution of the driver, two revolutions of the driver. All right, so two revolutions of the driver gives us three revolutions of the ball ring. So that's our fifth gear. One revolution input to 1.5 output.